Hey guys, it's Viger, and as you can probably see by the hat and the thumbnail, slightly different video than what we're usually doing, but hey, it's an SCP video, so that's kinda up my alley. But then it's also an infographics video, and why is that on my channel? Well, ordinarily I wouldn't have given them the time of day or even a little bit of attention to that regard, but SCP Illustrated, whom you may have known I do a little bit of collaboration with via Patreon and all that other stuff. Go check out his videos, they're very, very good. He tweeted out about Infographics doing an SCP video, and in typical Infographics fashion, very little research, if any research, was done into the subject, and it did SCP a very huge disservice, which, given that it's Infographics, doesn't really surprise me. But I do want to see how bad they got it, because apparently, according to the title, you can survive SCP-173, 096, and 682, which is not to say that it's impossible. But given how Infographics kind of does these sort of things, I feel as though it's not the way that we think it is. So this is probably going to be the first reaction where I'm not only going to be pausing the video to give context and sort of a discussion of the content, but also this is sort of my first critiquing and correction video, because I feel as though I need to do a lot of that with this. But with that being said, we are going to react slash critique slash correct Infographics video, You versus the SCP Foundation. So with that, unfortunately, being said, 3, 2, 1, go.
Everyone needs a summer job, but you just had to go and get a part-time position at the SCP Foundation, didn't you?
Okay, stop. Oh Christ, we're 6 seconds in and there's already one huge glaring issue with what was just said right there. The SCP Foundation does not do part-time work. That's just not how that freaking works. Also, a secretive organization just willfully putting a job application out there in the public for whatever schmuck wants to run in there and get a job kind of defeats the purpose of a secretive organization that keeps a veil of ignorance that keeps the public blind to the actual show that's running on in the background in the anomalous world. Okay, so aside from that, there is another glaring issue. There are four ways that an individual can work for the SCP Foundation. There are four specific ways one can do it, and neither of them is just being some random Joe on the street just saying, "I want to work for the Foundation." That's not how that freaking works. First way to do it, you need to be a really good doctor who's more than capable of dealing with all of the maiming, dismembering, injuries, and anomalous stuff, what have you, that's inflicted upon other people and everything. They need to be able to keep up healing people and dealing with all the other random stuff that's going to be happening in the background. Second way, being a really, really good scientist or researcher. There's information that needs to be logged, studied, and understood. We need scientists in order to understand the unexplainable when it comes to anomalies. It's kind of the bread and butter of the SCP Foundation. Third way is you could be a really good soldier. So if the Foundation needs a good fighting force when it comes to encountering hostile anomalies, hostile groups of interest, or just being part of a good mobile task force to investigate certain anomalies or anomalous locations to better understand and grapple with the situation. The fourth and final way that someone could come into working with the SCP Foundation is either if they are serving a life sentence or currently on death row. These kinds of people will inevitably end up as the D-class, or as the Foundation would really call them, guinea pigs. But, I mean, they were going to die anyway, so it's kind of how that freaking works. But, like I said, there would never, ever be a public application to work for the SCP Foundation. Only in the Broken Masquerade scenario would that ever freaking occur. But it would never, ever happen under normal circumstances. And again, not some random schmuck waltzing down the street would ever get the opportunity to do that. So already, 6 seconds in, and we have one huge glaring issue with this. So let's try and continue back with it. And go.
Technically, you're massively underqualified, but the employee turnaround at that company is so crazy that they can't exactly turn applicants away. Sure, you may die horribly at the hands of a number of beings, or get terminated for knowing too much, but the pay is decent, and the dental coverage can't be beat. However, you're now staring down the barrel of your first containment breach, and three of the Foundation's most terrifying creatures are on the loose. SCP-173, SCP-096,
oh, you're dead
and
now.
The dreaded SCP-682. Talk about a trial by fire. But don't worry, we're here for you with all the tips, tricks, and techniques you need to get these monsters back in their cells, or better yet, wiped from the face of the earth. So
they would stop. The Foundation would never, ever just up and destroy the anomalies that they have. That is a GOC, Global Occult Coalition thing that they would do. The SCP Foundation and the GOC are diametrically opposed to each other, and the Foundation does not terminate anomalies unless it is absolutely necessary. Usually the terminated SCPs that are in, or were in containment, which are now classified as neutralized, either had it done involuntarily to themselves, or it was literally no choice. Or, in the case of some SCPs like the Song of Genesis, an outside force came in and terminated the anomaly. So, yeah, again, Foundation would never, in a million years, destroy the anomalies that they have. They're not fully understood, and to terminate something that is not fully understood just invites a host of problems. What happens when you do terminate that anomaly? You've just made something even worse. So, yeah, we tread lightly here. And we just try and understand exactly what we have right at that moment. So, continuing on, go.
Steal yourself, Agent. Things are about to get horrifying. Are you ready to secure, contain, and protect? First up, we have SCP-173, a creature you should really be keeping an eye on. Seriously, if you take your eyes off this spooky statue for even a second, you'll find yourself laying on the ground with a snapped neck. While it might seem like a giant concrete fetus, this piece has left hardcore Class D personnel mined straight from death row in crumpled heaps on the ground. If you were going against this thing in a hand-to-hand battle, or with small arms like a handgun or a standard rifle, you'd better be turning the weapon on yourself before the entity had a chance to get its hands on you. Thankfully, you've got the nigh-unlimited resources and state-of-the-art weapons technology afforded to you by the Foundation, so at least you have a fighting chance. But no weapon in the fight against these mysterious beings is greater than knowledge. With know your enemy always being the first rule of conflict, let's get to knowing this nightmarish living statue and see whether there are any cracks in its concrete armor. SCP-
Stop, there aren't. I know that SCP Secret Laboratory does possess the means of, like, just shooting 173 enough, and then he just finally disintegrates. That's in a game sense. Knowing how SCP-173 functions, I wouldn't doubt it if somehow, someway, it's able to manipulate the environment enough so that it can overcome this obstacle. 173 was an artistic rendition that was born out of needing attention, as some of the tales with 173 specify. I mean, it just needs that human attention, and if it doesn't get it, it will find it. So if you try and kill it, it will do what it can to survive. And that would probably mean just using some sort of anomalous means of blinking the lights out, breaking eye contact, and going for the neck. So shooting 173 is probably not going to be your best alternative. And who's to say that the kick of the gun isn't going to cause you to suddenly blink for even just a split second, which will be just enough time for 173 to dodge the bullet, get behind you, and give you a nice good old crack. So, Strike one for info, no strike two. I've lost count already on infographics, so let's get back to it now.
173 is a Euclid-class being, meaning that the object has a certain degree of sentience, is difficult to contain, and is often unpredictable due to a lack of our understanding of said object. SCP-173 was moved into the containment site in 1993 and caused a number of brutal deaths since then. The exact origin of the creature and how it's able to move and cause damage is still a mystery, as it never moves while under direct observation. Despite apparently being a sentient creature, Foundation tests indicate that it's constructed from concrete and rebar, with the addition of some Krylon brand spray paint. It also somehow produces blood and feces, despite having no obvious digestive or vascular system. That's just one of the many perplexing things about the biology of this seemingly
impossible
creature.
It's because of the attention that it needs.
Typical containment procedures involve confining SCP-173 in a locked container under perpetual direct supervision from at least three Foundation personnel. While the observation personnel are released...
Stop. It's not perpetual, it's intermittently. Whenever 173's containment cell needs cleaning due to the buildup of blood and feces, 3D-class are sent in to monitor. It's required that 3 do show up, 2 to keep constant surveillance on 173, alerting each other when they have to blink so that constant 100% supervision is given to 173 at all times. The third member is the one that is cleaning and who is, in theory, safe to look away. But the other two need to keep constant surveillance. This isn't a perpetual thing. It's like a monthly thing, if my memory serves. I know it's not perpetual, but every so often, every, like clockwork, 173's containment cell is needed to be cleaned. So, already, 173, again, you're getting it wrong. Let's continue on. Go.
From their duties to change shift, at least two are required to maintain direct line-of-sight observation of the creature until the other personnel have safely vacated and locked the chamber. The creature is exceptionally fast and strong. Even the half-second it takes to blink is enough to get your neck brutally broken by this snap-happy statue. But these containment procedures apparently weren't enough, and now this wannabe weeping angel is on the loose, snapping its way through every SCP agent who can't maintain constant eye contact. How can you possibly fight a creature you can't look away from for even a fraction of a second? As the creature apparently lacks a conventional vascular system and doesn't appear to have standard carbon-based biological organs, it can't be poisoned or gassed into submission. You could go in guns blazing with heavy artillery weapons like the Metal Storm, this terrifying machine gun created by an Australian company with American funding for use on the US Navy ships, is a 36-barrel nightmare literally capable of unleashing upwards of 1 million rounds of parabolic hellfire within a minute. Surely this would reduce the SCP-173 to rubble, right? Well, perhaps—
Stop. It wouldn't. Again, like I said, 173 is smart enough that it would probably be able to do some sort of anomalous thing to cause the weapon system to malfunction, or it would just be able to cause some sort of anomalous phenomenon that would obstruct vision, allowing it to blink in and out of whatever it needed to do. So, nice try. You almost got me with that whole naval business, but even that won't cut it. Go.
Perhaps, unless the initial blast causes you to blink, and if that happens, then the creature is equally likely to dodge your firestorm and snap your neck. To truly beat this SCP, you won't need a hyper-advanced machine gun, but you will need a little help from one of mankind's oldest annoyances, the common housefly. Unlike humans, whose eyes need moisture to function properly and thus need to blink, flies have perpetually open compound eyes. This not only affords flies a wider field of perception, but the ability to stare forever without blinking. If you release a swarm of these annoying little creatures into a room with SCP-173, it'll essentially be paralyzed by the perpetual gaze of its hundreds of tiny guests. And when this slab of malicious concrete is rendered inert, it can be disposed of the same way you dispose of any troublesome concrete structure, TNT, or C4 charges, that could blast this prolific strangler to kingdom come.
Stop. Because of the whole idea of how and why the Foundation doesn't terminate anomalies, what's to say that the rubble that remains, and even the microscopic dust that was once 173, still doesn't carry its anomalous traits? And now you've just made a vaporized form that can literally be anywhere and everywhere and still capable of going for the good old snap. You just turned an anomaly that was once Euclid into a very, very big Keter problem, so... And again, the housefly thing probably wouldn't work either, because it requires human attention. As the tales would say that it would. They've tried AI systems, they've tried automated surveillance systems to keep this thing in check. It found a way around and then caused even bigger problems for the Foundation. They keep it with human surveillance because it frickin' works. The fly system probably wouldn't, and if it did momentarily, 173 would find a way around it, returning everything back to the baseline norm. Infographics, do a little bit of reading, please. Go.
The resulting rubble could then be simply destroyed in an industrial furnace, leaving no trace. Quite literally, done and dusted. But that murderous piece of modern art is child's play compared to your next opponent, SCP-096.
And we're all dead now.
The creature's chronic shyness could be the death of you, and it's potentially the death of everyone else too. This is another Euclid, but its combat potential is devastatingly higher than its concrete predecessor. According to all physical descriptions, it's a freakishly tall humanoid creature with white skin devoid of all pigmentation.
I can't wait to see how they think they can kill it.
Described by official files as being grossly out of proportion with the rest of the subject's body. Despite having an emaciated, almost malnourished appearance, the creature has seemingly impossible strength and ferocity during combat mode. The creature displays no higher intelligence or reasoning and appears largely docile while unprovoked. Containment procedures dictate that the being must be kept in an airtight steel cube with no surveillance equipment whatsoever. Why? Because this creature becomes truly dangerous when you see its face. That's right, if anyone anywhere sees SCP-096's face, whether it's physically or in a picture or video, the being enters a state of severe agitation. It will cover its face and begin crying and wailing loudly. When this period of despair ends, the creature begins a vicious rampage after whoever saw it, relentlessly tracking down its prey and eviscerating them, regardless of what's in the way. Witnesses have reported the creature tearing through doors, walls, and tanks with no effort whatsoever and experiencing severe physical damage, consistent with the destruction of most of its internal organs and barely even flinching. The creature's skeletal structure appears almost indestructible, and the only thing that can stop its rampage is the total annihilation of its target. So here's rule number one of taking the creature on. You cannot, under any circumstances, see its face. You can't really look at? Well, there is where some key details come into play. While in a combat scenario in which SCP-096 is in attack mode, it has been shown to recover from damage sustained from around 1,050 caliber bullets and sustained fire from an anti-tank gun. It may not have this same level of invulnerability in its docile state.
Stop. It does. Just because it's in its docile state doesn't mean that anything about its biology has freaking changed. Its mindset is the only thing that has changed, because it goes from doing nothing to being so overly aggressive, no force in basically the entire universe. Not even 682 could stop it. And to think that you can come up with some way to just kill it while it's docile? You couldn't kill it when it was aggravated. Okay, let's, I guess, continue on. Go.
Perhaps you could catch this self-conscious creature off guard by approaching it while using the T7 Thermal Imaging FLIR Binocular Goggle System. The creature becomes an unstoppable killing machine when you see its face, but through using a thermal imaging system,
you'd
merely be viewing its abstract heat signature without any real facial depth.
Stop. Scrambler! For Christ's sake! They did it already, and it didn't frickin' work! They tried the exact same thing. It was called Scrambler, where it literally took the image of 096, literally jumbled up the face into a whole bunch of different pixels so that you couldn't actually identify it. And to be quite honest, I don't even know where I'm frickin' going with this anymore. I'm just... There's an entire field report about this where it's like, they did exactly just this. They put a thing over their face to say, hey, you can't see its face, and it still didn't freaking work. because there was a nanosecond of time where unfiltered light of 096's face got to the retina, was processed by the brain, immediately forgotten, and that counted. So, your little thermal imaging magic with your little magic headset and everything, the Foundation tried it. It didn't freaking work. Again, trying to catch this thing off guard. What? That's not... Read 096's file. It says it all freaking there. I know I shouldn't be getting this aggravated, and it sounds like I'm putting on a show, but this is just... This is just unacceptable. This is just... Okay. Let's try and continue on. I'm afraid of what they're going to say about 682. I am so afraid of how they think they're going to be able to kill the unkillable lizard. Let's continue on. Go.
In other words, thermal imaging goggles like this would allow you to view SCP-096 without really seeing it. And when the creature kills its target and returns to its docile state, you finally have the opportunity to show it some real firepower. While this SCP is incredibly effective at ground combat, it hasn't shown the same prowess against aerial vehicles, like the devastating MQ-9 Reaper UAV, a remote-controlled drone with ungodly firepower.
Stop. In the exact same file where it says Scrambler didn't freaking work, there was clear and obvious freaking evidence that it jumped high enough to rip a plane out of the sky. Oh my Christ. They didn't read anything about it. And no, shooting a missile wouldn't freaking work either. Again, 096 went toe-to-toe with 682, and 682 still didn't kill 096. Christ almighty. It's like they didn't even try. Go.
While this creature may be able to survive an anti-tank gun while in its offensive mode, could it survive a volley of immensely powerful AGM-114 Hellfire II anti-armor missiles fired from above while in its docile state?
Absolutely.
We can't exactly be sure. But it's unlikely that even if it did survive, whatever's left could put up much of a fight, injecting the skeletal remains with powerful fluoroantimonic acid, much like a Spinal Tap procedure, might be the final nail in the coffin for this emotionally volatile monster. Even the most powerful acids, however, don't mean much to our third and final combatant. That's right, the utterly horrifying SCP-682, otherwise known by the foreboding nickname, the hard-to-kill reptile. Even this feels like a gross underestimation of the power of this creature. It's the first Keter-class SCP on the list here, meaning anomalies that are exceedingly difficult to contain consistently or reliably, with containment procedures often being extensive and complex. That's right, the two other Euclids were just a warm-up. The Keter-class are the big daddies, and SCP-682 is probably the most dangerous and durable of them all. It's an extremely intelligent and ferocious reptile-like creature with unparalleled regenerative ability, reflexes, and strength. It also seems to detest all forms of life in our dimension, and is bent on the destruction of any living being it can get its claws on. The beast is also so adaptable that it's almost impossible to use the same method of attack on it twice. Even other SCPs have proved unable to terminate the creature during cross-testing. In order to contain SCP-682, it's perpetually kept in a sealed vat of powerful hydrochloric acid, continually melting its body to prevent it from reaching its full potential. If this thing gets out while you're on duty, you better either prepare your last will and testament or get ready to negotiate a raise. There's no proven way to take on this nigh-unkillable beast, so any methods of assault would ultimately just be guesswork and wishful thinking. Still, we believe there are a few potential methods for putting this misanthropic immortal lizard out of commission.
Stop. I'm just going to alert you right now. Foundation already tried, or doesn't want to give it the opportunity to adapt to the method that you're about to say that you think will freaking work. So, that being said, let's continue. Go.
Even if not all of them are permanent solutions to the problem, the first option involves a lot of creativity and a lot of bullets. Remember earlier in the video when we mentioned the Metal Storm, the experimental Navy machine gun capable of firing a million bullets per minute? Such a weapon could be a lot more useful against the fleshy body of SCP-682. Coupled with high-intensity flamethrowers, which are illegal under the Geneva Convention, but hey, legality has never stood in the way of the Foundation before, if over 87% of the body is damaged or destroyed, the body will be compromised enough for temporary incapacity.
Stop. That might be right. But 87% still means that 682 is still technically alive. So there's no real docile state. There's just a time when it's starting to recuperate, regenerate, and adapt to the very method that you just tried to use to kill it. They've already tried a whole bunch of guns, they've already tried a whole bunch of flamethrowers. Even freaking SCP-001, the Gate Guardian, couldn't obliterate it. And you think bullets and fire is gonna freaking work on this thing? My head hurts.
Patient. Go. If you act fast, this is when you have the greatest chance of survival. If the incapacitated body was once again placed in high-intensity acid, this containment unit could then itself be transferred to the payload of an autonomous rocket, much like the kind used to launch satellites into the far reaches of space. If you want to be truly rid of this immortal lizard, firing its desiccated, still-living carcass into the infinity of space is definitely one way you could go about it. Not to mention the fact that given the Foundation has almost unlimited resources, a SpaceX-style private launch would definitely not be out of the financial question. Though, of course, if you want a less complicated solution to your SCP-682 problem, there's another form of rocketry that could come to your aid – nuclear-armed intercontinental ballistic missiles. There's no way of stating with 100% certainty that one or even several nuclear ICBMs would actually kill the beast, but there's pretty much nothing else these bad boys can't kill, so you're in there with a chance. If SCP-682 was caught within the hypocenter of the blast, which is anywhere within 1 mile of the direct explosion, there's a good chance that its organic matter would be reduced to atoms by the sheer force of the blast's thermal energy.
Stop. Just stop. They tried that. A proposal was sent to the O5 to say, hey, drop a 50-ton nuclear warhead on the damn thing. And the O5 said no, because they didn't want to deal with the possibility of 682 adapting to a nuclear strike. Because once you try and nuke it and that doesn't freaking work, what other option do you have to contain it? And atomizing the sucker is not going to freaking work. If you know 682 as well as I do, those atoms are just simply going to reconstitute themselves back into what 682 once was, and you've just made him even angrier. And once 682 is angry, which is all the freaking time, let's see how they wrap this up. Go.
However, seeing as the SCP Foundation keeps any facility holding SCP-682 around 50 kilometers away from developed human settlements, you wouldn't need to stop there. If anything did remain, the area could be salted with napalm and the same powerful hydrochloric acid used to contain it. In prior tests, the creature had been damaged to the extent that only around 20% of its biomass remained prior to regeneration. It stands to reason that the most thorough way to ensure the beast's destruction is to strike with such rapid and overwhelming force it doesn't even have time to adapt or repair. In other words, the only way to really kill SCP-682 is absurd, heavy artillery overkill. But that's a small price to pay for not only your life, but the survival of the human race. And of course, your end-of-year company bonus. Check out the rest of our You Versus playlist for more exciting battles between average Joes and pop culture's most formidable foes. Thanks for watching.
Holy shit. They literally think you can kill 682. Clearly, they didn't look at any one of the many, many, and still growing tests that they've done to try and kill the sucker. They threw it in a freaking void, which, might I add, doesn't freaking exist. It stopped 682 stopped existing, and then came back. I mean, infographics. What the frick was that? Literally, everything you've just said in that video was freaking wrong. It's like you never even opened up the wiki and actually looked at the files, looked at the stories, looked at the facts that we all know. The story goes, 682 cannot, will not, and never will be killed. 173 will always remain fully intact because you can't destroy it, because even the microscopic dust of what 173 is will still technically be 173 with all the choking power that it still required. And 096 cannot, should not, and will probably never be looked at face to face with any sort of headgear to try and protect your precious little vision, because it will still find you, it will still kill you, no matter how much you try and scramble its freaking face. But holy crap, that was hard to look at. I don't know whether or not to try and turn this around into a joke or just to remain as angry and agitated as I am already. I mean, I'm all down for making SCP videos, but this is not the one that I thought I'd have to make. Oh, Christ almighty. Well, I guess that's the end of this video. Ordinarily, I'd say check out Infographics for more videos on their style, but not this one. Because this is just all sorts of wrong. Yeah, just check out the description for all the different plugs and everything that need to be shouted out and everything. I trust you guys that you know what to do. And with that being said, I'll see you guys when I see you guys. And as always, toodles.